Good afternoon, everyone. I want to welcome you and thank you for coming today to our presentation, Are Your Digital Communications Accessible? By the University of Washington Accessibility Technology Expert, Terrill Thompson. My name's Tom Minty, and I'm with the Northwest Universal Design Council. And I want to thank you all for being here today. Typically, you think of universal design, or most people think of universal design as dealing with the built environment, frequently in terms of our residential experience. But universal design is really a set of seven principles to which everything can be applied. Equitability of use, flexibility, simple and intuitive use, perception of information or perceptible information, a tolerance for error, low physical effort, and space and size for approach and use. Those are, and certainly, number six is a low physical effort and size and space for approach. These are the principles that can and are also used in our digital communications, and that's what we're going to talk about today. Before we get started, I want to thank some of the people that were involved today, the City of Seattle specifically, City Clerk Monica Martinez-Simmons, the Legislative Department and Finance and Administration Services for this venue, the Human Services Department and Aging and Disability Services for staffing the Universal Design Council and coordinating today's event, and in particular, Irene Stewart, would die without. And I'd also like to thank Doug Hilde, who's with us here today, who is also on our steering committee for the Northwest Universal Design Council. And it was in our communications with Doug that a lot of this issue came up, and he was very instrumental in getting this done today. So thank you, Doug. I'd also like to thank those who gave us promotional, emotional, and physical support, specifically Allie C., spelled A11YSEA, which is the Seattle Area Accessibility and Inclusive Design Meetup Group, the Seattle Commission for People with Disabilities, Seattle Department of Neighborhoods, Seattle IT, including the Seattle Channel and Community Technology Literacy and Access Programs, and Seattle Channel is recording this today, the Seattle Public Library LEAP Program, which stands for the Library Equal Access Program, and the Healthy Aging Partnership, a community-based coalition of aging network organizations. Most of all, I'd like to thank Terrill for being here today and sharing this topic with us. Terrill works for the University of Washington as Information Technology and Accessibility Specialist throughout the University of Washington as well as the world. He collaborates with a wide variety of stakeholders. Terrill has over 20 years of experience in the IT accessibility field. He has presented at numerous conferences and consulted widely with government, private industry, educational entities on IT accessibility issues. So without further delay, I'd like you to help me welcome Terrill Thompson.
Thank you. It's great to see such a large crowd on a Thursday afternoon. You never know what you're going to get talking about accessibility and universal design. Sometimes it's just a handful of people, and even those can be very rich conversations. But I really get thrilled when there are a lot of people who are interested in this topic and wanting to engage about this. So ideally, every presentation would be to a crowd like this. So thank you. Appreciate you coming out today. So I am with the University of Washington, and I've already gotten a couple of questions about sort of how accessibility works at the University of Washington. So I thought I would share a little bit about kind of my role within the university. I'm not in disability services, which provides students, disability resources for students, provides services to students with disabilities. And there's the disability services office, which provides services to employees with disabilities, and I'm not with them either. I'm actually kind of uniquely positioned as an accessibility person within IT, And so that's kind of unusual, although it's happening more and more across college campuses all over the country, in that information technology, websites, videos, computer labs, all the things that we do with information technology, software, there are accessibility issues with that. And it makes sense that the people that need to address those accessibility issues reside within an information technology climate. So the people that are responsible for deploying those technologies are responsible for ensuring that they're accessible. So that's the philosophy at the UW, and it has been for a long time. Since the early 90s, maybe even before that, accessible technology was positioned within the information technology group, the central computing group. And so that's my department is accessible technology services. So it's a small group that resides within UWIT, and we work collaboratively with people all over campus to ensure that the technologies that we're using are fully accessible. So that's my role at the university. And I've got three logos up on the title slide here. The first is the W, the University of Washington logo. And then over on the opposite side is Do It. How many of you have heard of Do It? Okay, about half the hands go up, or slightly fewer than that. But that stands for Disabilities, Opportunities, Internetworking, and Technology. And it's an organization that was originally funded back in 1993 by the National Science Foundation and still receives grants from the National Science Foundation and lots of other sources. But it is a group within UWIT that partners with the College of Sciences, College of Engineering, Computer Science and Engineering, and originally with the College of Education. And it's a collaborative effort to empower kids with disabilities starting from high school who are interested in college, who are interested in challenging careers, getting them to come to the university for a summer immersion program. And then we have a number of grants that we've gotten over the years that sort of piggyback off that effort and work to break down barriers for these kids. So they come and they get sort of the college experience and they learn what it's going to be like going to a university, what sort of accommodations they might receive, how to self-advocate, how college is going to be different from high school, and all sorts of things related to transitioning from high school into college, transitioning into employment. So we work with the kids, we work with their schools, we work with colleges and universities, we work with employers just to try and carve out a path so that they can succeed at whatever it is that they want to succeed at. So that's what Do It does. And the third logo up there is Access Computing, and that is one of the grant-funded projects that Do It works on in collaboration with the Computer Science Department, specifically focused on broadening participation of people with disabilities in computing careers. So that's a major focus and a major funder of my position. And so that's why the logo is up there to pay homage to the funding source that makes my being here in part possible. So also up here, there's some contact information. So that's important if you want to reach out to me afterwards. I'm happy to have conversations about accessibility with anybody. TFT are my initials, Tango Foxtrot Tango, at uw.edu. And also on Twitter, if anybody does that, Terrill Thompson on Twitter. So we're here to explore digital communication. And I wanted to start with a slide that I consider really pretty stellar and pretty beautiful. It is if I can do my best to add some alt text to this, it's a brilliant golden sphere with touches of other colors mixed in, but all of these points within the sphere are interconnected. So there are dots and there are lines that connect those dots, and you know they're all interconnected. Some are big, some are small, and ultimately it creates this really huge, brilliant thing. Anybody know what this is? Okay, representation of the GitHub repository. Very good guess and very close, but very tiny. That actually comprises one of those dots, but there's much more.
It's a demonstration of poor contrast in a badly lit room.
Okay. If it were, and this is the room's role in this, and we can't say, no, that doesn't have poor contrast, because it does in this context. But if you look at it in a dark room, it actually has very good contrast. But this is the internet. This is actually a map of the internet that a person whose name escapes me, but project is called the OPTE project, and you can find out about it at opte.org, OPTE.org. And this was the vision of a person who had severe dyslexia, but was a very visual person, and he sort of tells his story on the opte.org website. But he set out to map the internet, and this is the outcome of that project. So this is an actual representation of all of the nodes on the internet and how they all connect. And when he, you know, started doing this, he came to realize how incredible this is at just communicating the vastness of the internet. And really, it is kind of a beautiful thing. We don't necessarily think of the internet as a beautiful thing, but when you step back and look at it in this context, it really is quite stunning and quite a work of art. I've got some numbers here to also communicate the vastness of the internet and all of those internetworkings and the communication that's happening. And this actually is a somewhat old slide. I used it in another presentation. So it's possible and likely, actually, that these numbers have grown significantly since I put this slide together. But you can get live data at internetlivestats.com. And it's constantly ticking away like a stock ticker. But you'll find there that there are nearly 3 billion, and probably by now 3 billion internet users, nearly 1 billion websites, and maybe more than that by now, over 96 billion emails sent today alone, nearly 2 billion Google searches today, over 3 billion videos viewed today on YouTube, and over 1.2 billion active Facebook users. So those are huge numbers. And it just it makes me appreciate how interconnected we are. In some cases, for better or worse, but if we just focus on the positive, there's a lot of really great collaboration, communication, unprecedented connection with people all over the world that we've never had quite like we have today. So again, I find this a very beautiful thing. And if you think about those numbers, all those billions of people collaborating and connecting and working together and accessing the internet and doing different things on the internet and functioning in society in different ways, do you think of a typical computer user? Where here we have a slide that has a silhouette of a person, seems to be male, there's no hair in this silhouette, sitting at a desktop computer with a desktop monitor using a mouse. How many of you relate to this person? How many of you feel like, that's me up there, I'm a typical computer user just like that person? Okay, not many hands go up, 7 or 8 hands go up. And so my point in sharing that is that if you think about all those billions of users out there, there are a few that do resemble that person. But there are a lot of people that don't resemble that person, that really there is no typical computer user. The typical computer user, kind of the standard model for interacting with a computer, is you've got a monitor that you use to access output. You've got a keyboard that you use for input, and that came first, and then a little bit later, the mouse. So you might also have a mouse for input. That's the traditional model, but that's pretty old-fashioned by today's standards. A lot of people, we see this everywhere, particularly on the college campus, everybody's walking around with their mobile device, you know, accessing whatever they're accessing, communicating with people, and doing all sorts of things with their mobile device. This happens to be an iPhone that's pictured here, but even with our phones, we have a wide variety. We've got Androids, we've got Windows mobile devices, and the experience on each of these devices is going to be different. So depending on which device a user has, they're going to be perceiving things very differently than the person next to them. Some people have tablets, and there too, you've got a lot of different flavors, a lot of different shapes and sizes, and that impacts the experience that that person is having. You've got some people who are not using a monitor, so they're not visually looking at content, and even on a phone, they might not be visually looking at content. I actually navigated here using Siri, so she walked me through where I needed to go to get to City Hall. So I was using an audible interface. People who can't see have, for a long time, I mean, when we think of audible interfaces, we have thought of people who are using screen readers and listening to content audibly. But now it's much more broad than that. There are lots of people who need, for various reasons, to be interacting hands-free with information technology, and so listening to content is more and more common among everybody. You have people who use speech recognition. So, you know, voice input as opposed to using the keyboard, using a mouse. And here again, that traditionally has been the realm of individuals with disabilities who maybe couldn't use the keyboard or the mouse or couldn't use them efficiently. And so voice became a viable means for them to interact with technology. Now you've got a lot more people who are using voice. Again, Siri comes to mind, that I can prompt Siri with a voice command and she then responds with whatever information I'm needing at the time. So more and more people are interacting using voice. We also have people who are interacting using touch. So rather than listening to content audibly, they might be feeling content through a refreshable Braille display. And this goes both ways. They might be using the Braille for input and Braille for output. So this, I had to stop because I ran out of room on the slide, but I could go on and on and on sharing different examples of how people interact with technology and access the internet and access email and all that. And it's incredibly rich and incredibly diverse. Just a couple weeks ago, I was in San Diego at the CSUN Conference on Technology and Disability. Huge conference with what used to be, I think, hundreds, and it's a little bit smaller now, but lots and lots of vendors who are exhibiting assistive technologies. And there's just so much assistive technology that's out there that really anybody who can twitch a muscle can use a computer. There are assistive technologies to provide access. And that just helps to sort of communicate that it's so rich and so diverse, the different ways that people are accessing technology and communicating. So even those of us that access content visually using a monitor have a wide range of differences. So here's a screenshot that shows the screen resolutions from my MacBook Pro. Anywhere from 640 by 480 to 1680 by 1050. So lots of different shapes and sizes and all points in between, stretched, not stretched. There are over a dozen different choices that I have for how to configure my computer so that it looks the way I need and has, you know, a display that is adequate for the size that I need, the font size, the icon size, and so forth. And within browsers, I've got a lot of flexibility too. This is a screenshot from Firefox where the default font size is 16 pixels. I can change that from 9 if I want really tiny fonts, which some people for some reason like, on up to 72. Pixels. And so you've got a lot of variation, and it's very easy just to go into preferences and change the font size within your browser. So what this all means is that there's so much variety, and as people are creating content and creating applications and web pages and so forth, they need to understand that what they see right now as they're building something is completely different, probably, from what a lot of people are going to see or going to experience. So people are all going to experience their communication differently than what they might be envisioning. And so there's got to be some flexibility there and some understanding. People all fall somewhere on this continuum between able and not able, depending on what function you happen to be talking about. So I'd like to argue that the notion of disability, not disability, is a little bit of an artificial notion. And I realize that there are reasons why people can claim to have a disability, and there are, you know, laws associated with that and benefits that are associated with that. But when it comes right down to it, it just depends on what we're talking about. If we're talking about the ability to see, then how many of you have 20/20 vision? Okay, there are 3-4 people in the crowd. There always are a few that have 20/20 vision. A few people here are not able to see at all. And most of us fall somewhere in between. And, you know, if we were to plot that out, it would be a very broad spectrum, I bet, on the ability to see scale. If we look at ability to hear, again, you're going to have a very broad spread. The ability to walk, the ability to read print, the ability to write with pen or pencil, the ability to communicate verbally, to tune out distraction, on and on and on we could go. And the continuum is going to be full of dots. So if we were to plot that, there would be kind of a central cluster, probably in the middle, that is a bit thicker than the others. But there are going to be some outliers that are very good at whatever this function happens to be. And there are going to be some that are not so good. But those people that are not so good are going to be better on other dimensions. So it really just depends on what you're looking at. So the point, again, is that there's a ton of diversity. Everybody's different. Everybody's good at some things, not so good at some things. And this whole notion of disability is, yeah, as a binary thing, that yes, you either have it or you don't, is really an artificial construct. So a lot of people use assistive technologies to accommodate their disability and help them to perform things that they couldn't do otherwise. So headphones, for example, represent here listening to content. So if you can't see the screen, then you can listen to it. That's an assistive technology. A screen reader is an assistive technology that makes that possible. A refreshable braille device makes that communication possible. Speech recognition, the ability to control a computer and to provide input to a computer with voice alone, makes that possible for somebody that's not able to use a keyboard or use a mouse. A calculator is an assistive technology for somebody who is not able to perform mathematical calculations in their head. So, complex mathematical calculations. Most people can't do it. And so we depend on having this assistive technology that helps us perform that function. Eyeglasses. A lot of people have eyeglasses in the room. I've got contact lenses. And it's an assistive technology that helps with vision, corrects vision to make people see a little better than they can otherwise. And then, of course, wheelchairs. Being able to get around if somebody is not physically able to get around. So for example, let's say we've got that assistive technology. We are in need of a wheelchair, and we're in our wheelchair, and we're sitting at the bottom of this government building, which has 2 or 3 dozen steps to get up into the entryway. How are we going to get inside this building? It's a government building, so you know, we need to get in there to participate in the democratic process. How do we get in? Any ideas? Yes?
We pass a bill. I was actually, 1977, we passed it here in the Handicap Congress. We have access to the federal building.
Okay. So
statewide first.
Okay, so that's one thing. It's going to be a long process. You're at the bottom of this stairway, and you want to get in, so you pass a bill, and you advocate, talk to your government leaders, and eventually, you have a law, and eventually that translates into access. But in the meanwhile, you need to get in there, and so a ramp would be a solution. What else?
Elevator.
Okay, an elevator would be a solution. So, what do those things have in common? What does a ramp and an elevator have in common? As opposed to you, the other alternative would be you getting a wheelchair. The wheelchair that's on the slide here, if you look closely at it, is a rocket-powered wheelchair that goes from something like 0 to 100 in 5 seconds. There actually is a website with, if you search for jet-powered wheelchair, there's this kind of crazy product that's on an assistive technology website. I think it's really not for sale, and it has a ridiculous price tag, but kind of a fun thing. But even if you had that wheelchair, so that might be where you as an individual, you could get up these stairs with that wheelchair. But most people don't have that wheelchair. So instead, a ramp, an elevator, that's a change to this built environment, right? So one scenario is you taking this on and addressing the challenge yourself by getting a better wheelchair. The other is the building needs to be adapted so that it is more universally designed so people can get inside. So what we want to do, we're here to talk about technology and digital communications, but this same metaphor applies, that we need to not just expect the user to get assistive technology. You can't access this, then get a screen reader or get a better screen reader. But the technologies that we are providing in the communications that we're providing via technology, like websites and documents, need to be created in a way that has universal design built in. So the ramps and the elevators, our documents need to have those things so that people can read them. So we're going to talk about the nuts and bolts of that so you'll understand what that means exactly. How do I build an elevator in my document that I'm creating or on my web page? So we're going to look at three examples and sort of dissect those in some depth. The types of questions that we want to ask as we're looking at inaccessible technology and digital communications are things like, can I access it without sound? Is it critical that I be able to hear this? And if I can't hear this, then how can it be adapted so that I can access it? So in this case, captions would be a solution. If you got captions on videos, then yes, I can access this without sound. If you've got a transcript, so in some cases, captions aren't enough. If somebody's got really low internet bandwidth, then they're not going to be able to play the video, therefore they're not going to be able to see the captions that are synchronized with the video. So having a transcript would give them access to the content. Can I access it without a mouse? So here's a screenshot of a webinar environment where there's a lot of stuff going on. There's a PowerPoint slide, there's a chat interface, there's a list of attendees, there potentially is a video with the speaker's face talking. If it's a good accessible environment, then there would be live captioning as well. And got a few sort of links and resources in the lower portion of the screen. Who's going to have difficulty accessing this tool? Anyone. Could be very challenging to a lot of people. As the title suggests, can I access it without a mouse? A lot of the functions here, one would typically click in order to access them. So where do I ask a question of the speaker? Well, there is a place down at the bottom of the second panel where There's some sort of prompt to enter your question here. So a mouse user with eyesight would just click in that spot and would be able to type. But what if a person can't use a mouse? Can they tab to that spot? And can they type their question then? Is it clear when they get there where they are? And are they able to fully function without using a mouse? There actually are stickers over on the red table as you came in. Feel free to grab some of those on the way out. No mouse stickers. And so what you see up on the slide here is the same thing on these stickers. So I encourage you to promote this. But take the no mouse challenge with hashtag no mouse. So this is something, anywhere, if you're on social networks, on Twitter, Facebook, anywhere where you can use a hashtag, use the no mouse hashtag. And also visit nomouse.org to find out what this is all about. But the short version is just try using any web page without using a mouse. Resist the urge to touch your mouse if you are a mouse user. And maybe even go beyond that and spend an entire day without touching your mouse. And particularly if you spend an entire day in front of a computer. All the websites, all the software, everything that you normally would do by clicking on things and dragging and moving your mouse around, don't use your mouse at all and just see what that experience is like. And this is just one accessibility issue among many when we're talking about websites, but it's often a really good indicator of whether a website is accessible or not. So if you can't use it without a mouse, if there are just functions there like drop-down menus or other controls, buttons on a media player, things that you have to have a mouse in order to access, then chances are this website has a lot of accessibility problems. If maybe it's even keyboard accessible, but you can't figure out where you are. There's no visible focus that's sort of tracking where you are as you tab through the page, then that's going to be really not usable for somebody without a mouse. So take the no mouse challenge and then use the no mouse hashtag to share your experience with the world and encourage other people to take the no mouse challenge, particularly people that have some responsibility for websites. Just ask them, have you tried this without a mouse? And if not, you should try it and see what the experience is like. It can be very enlightening. Can I access it without seeing it? So those of you that can see, we have a document up here on the screen. This is an introduction to physics course syllabus. So it has all the things you need to know about the physics course that you're about to take, and including the course objectives and all of the assigned reading and grades are broken down, what percentage of your grade is this versus that versus the other. So let's ask just a couple of basic questions, like how many course objectives are there? Okay, nobody is shouting out the answer. A lot of people shaking their heads, and a lot of people seem frustrated. Some people think this is a silly exercise. But if I was your physics professor, you wouldn't be laughing. Maybe you would. Very hard to, that information is here, and it's hard to see with the poor contrast in the room, but even if you could read this, it's hard to extract that information, right? Why is it hard to extract that information? There's no formatting.
It's physics.
There's no hierarchy. There's no structure, and
it's small.
There are lots of things wrong with this, but the one I really want to emphasize is that there's no structure. It's just a big blob of text. If we visually format this and add structure to it, this is actually what it looks like. It's still pretty small, but I can describe it. There's a banner across the top that says Accessible University, so that's the name of this fictitious university. There's a main heading, big, bold, centered text that says Introduction to Physics Course Syllabus. There are four subheadings that are also big and bold, but they're left justified instead of centered, and so that's how I know they're different than the main heading. There's one is textbook, one is course objectives, one is class schedule, and one is grades. And underneath each of those headings, you've got some content. Under the textbook heading, there's a paragraph. Underneath course objectives, there are three list items, each with a bullet in front of it. And so I ask how many objectives there are. If you look at this visually, then that's an easy question, because there are three bullets underneath the course objectives heading. So all of that becomes very easy to access because there's structure. So the problem that we encounter a lot in the digital accessibility realm is that that structure is a fake structure. It's a visual-only structure that looks structured. Those headings look like headings, but maybe they're just big and bold and centered text, not really headings. They're just like this, just a big blob of text. And some of that text is pretending to be something that it really isn't. Under the hood, it's just plain text with no structure. So what I'm getting at is that when you have a heading, whether that this is in a web page or in a Word document or in a PDF, it needs to be tagged as a heading. And there are ways to do that in all of those tools. So you need to mark up headings as, you know, heading one if it's the main heading, heading two if it's a subheading. If you have a list of items, then you need to use the list tool that's built into your word processing platform. Or on a web page, you need to use the proper markup so that a list actually is a list. All of this information gets communicated to assistive technology users, and particularly we're talking about people that can't see the page. So a screen reader will announce headings and will provide functions that enable users to jump from heading to heading to heading and, you know, explore the organization of the page very easily, very quickly. But they have to actually be headings in order for that to work. And they have to be lists, and they have to be tables, and so forth. So without that kind of structure and proper accessible markup, then you end up with a big blob of text that really is meaningless and very, very difficult to understand. So we'll get into a bit further detail as we plunge further into this problem. So the question that I want to explore kind of throughout the day is, who's responsible for this? And also, this is a way for me to get to know the audience a little bit. But there are five groups, and I can think of a couple other groups that fit into this too, but five main groups that are responsible for ensuring that digital communication is accessible. One of those is the assistive technologies themselves. So they certainly play a role because that's the tool that a lot of users are going to be using. At the center of this, we have accessibility standards. So there has to be a central way that says this is how you need to tag a web page in order to ensure that it's accessible. And this is how you need to tag a document so that it's accessible. And those standards do exist, and we'll talk about those in a moment. But so that's kind of the heart of things. That's what makes communication happen. But then we have assistive technologies that need to support those standards. We have software and operating systems that need to support those standards. We have web developers and content authors. Anybody who's producing a document or producing a web page needs to also support those standards. So if you design a web page or create a document that complies with the standards, then assistive technologies that support the standards, software that supports the standards, they all do the right thing and deliver that in a way that works for their users. So, but all of these parties need to be on board with the standards. and then also web authoring and development tools. Need to make it easier for you as an author or a content developer. You know, there are millions, billions of authors, and so it's pretty daunting to think that they all need to understand accessibility standards, and probably is never going to happen. But if the web authoring and development tools automatically create accessible content, then that relieves authors of a little bit of the burden. So how many of you identify with assistive technologies? How many of you are assistive technology developers? Okay, there are a few users that whose hands went down. No AT developers here. If I had asked that question at CSUN a couple weeks ago, then a lot of hands would have gone up. What about software and operating system developers? Anybody here from Microsoft or elsewhere? Okay, one hand goes up. And because there's only one, do you mind if I pick on you? And who?
Sure.
Where are you from?
Starbucks.
Okay, Starbucks, okay. Okay, so he represents a team that builds websites and mobile apps on behalf of Starbucks, okay? So then you also identify with the web authoring, or with the web developer and content author piece. How many of you are web developers? Let's start with web developers. How many of you develop websites? Okay, about 10, 15 hands go up or so. How many of you author any sort of digital content, create documents, or compose emails? Okay, most hands go up. How many of you are involved in accessibility standards groups? Okay, quite a few hands go up there, so that's great. About 10 hands or slightly fewer went up for that. So let's look at some examples. We'll start with web pages. How many of you, I'm gonna venture into HTML and tags just a little bit, not enough to be painful. But how many of you are afraid when I start talking about HTML tags? Okay, a few hands go up. How many of you are okay if I talk about tags a little bit? Okay, so most hands go up there. I couldn't change my talk really, so. So HTML, the language, this is hypertext markup language, the language that makes the web what it is. This is the language behind the web. It's been around since 1993. This is when it was invented by Tim Berners-Lee, the person that we see on the screen up there. And in one of the very early drafts of HTML, this is 1.2, which still is out there on the internet. There was a 1.1 that I don't know if that still exists, but 1.2 is still out there. And it really is just Tim Berners-Lee kind of scribbling some ideas down. There are a lot of typos. It's really sort of odd as a technical standard to see this. But he included in HTML heading tags, H1 through H6, which are designed to form an outline. So you've got H1 being the main heading of a page, H2 being subheadings. And if you need them, then you go further down. So H3s, H4s, but they form an outline of the heading structure of the page. And he said, even in this very early draft of HTML, he said, it is not normal practice to jump from one header to a header level more than one below. For example, to follow an H1 with an H3. Although this is legal, it is discouraged, as it may produce strange results, for example, when generating other representations from the HTML. So this really is a key issue when we talk about web accessibility, that those headings need to form an outline. So a user, a screen reader user, can jump from heading to heading to heading, and they can really get a good understanding of the relationships between all the parts and can understand the outline and the structure of the page. And so this was built in from the beginning. This was a part of the HTML standard from the beginning. So accessibility has always been there. Also, in HTML 1.2, there was an image tag, which allows you to add pictures and photos and artwork, visual artwork to web pages. But even in that early, when image was introduced, alt was also introduced. So you could add alternate text to an image so that somebody who can't see it gets a short description of that image. So that has been there since the beginning. Tim Berners-Lee, after he created the web, also founded the World Wide Web Consortium. So that was then an organization of people representing a lot of different sectors in society who had an interest in the web and who then became kind of the standards body. So they are responsible for maintaining the HTML specification and other standards and specifications that apply to the web. So HTML is theirs, cascading style sheets, which is a markup language that's used for decorating web content and controlling how it's presented. And they also recognized very early on that the web had a lot of potential to break down barriers for people who otherwise had been struggling with, you know, inaccessible print content and trying to get alternative versions of things. But now they could access all sorts of information via the internet. So it had a lot of potential to break down barriers. But they also recognized that it had the potential to introduce new barriers. And so very early on in the history of the W3C, they created a web accessibility initiative. So there's a group of people that got together to specifically look at this problem of web accessibility. And they came out with the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, sometimes called WCAG, W-C-A-G. Version 1 came out in the late 1990s, so it's been around for a very long time, specifically telling us how to create accessible web pages. And version 2.0 is the more contemporary version of that set of guidelines. And then there's another new specification called ARIA, stands for Accessible Rich Internet Applications. And that is a specification that allows a very complex, rich, dynamic web applications to be accessible to people with disabilities. So particularly people who are using assistive technologies, they can understand what's going on the page when things are changing and moving in response to user behavior, because ARIA communicates that to their assistive technologies. So these are just some examples of how the W3C has integrated accessibility into their standards. A bit more information about the WCAG in particular. It became an official W3C recommendation or an official standard in 2008. It has four broad principles, and that is that content needs to be perceivable, regardless of how you might perceive it, maybe visually, maybe audibly, maybe through tactile interface. You need to be able to perceive the content. It needs to be operable, so you need to be able to operate the links, the buttons, the sliders, any of the controls that you might use a mouse for. You need to also be able to operate with just the keyboard or with speech or with whatever your input modality might happen to be. It needs to be understandable. So we shouldn't have to be rocket scientists to try and figure out, you know, what's going on in this web page and how do I interact with it. And it needs to be robust, which means that as the web evolves or as technologies evolve that are capable of displaying web content and delivering web content, then our web pages should still work on those new devices. We don't want to have to go back and redesign the web page, redesign the web, and, you know, redo all of our pages because we have new devices. That, you know, they need to be robust and they need to be able to sort of transform themselves regardless of what sort of tools people are using. And so within these four principles, there are very specific success criteria, as they're called. So it basically is a checklist of things that you need to do in order to be accessible. There's 62 of those, so that's where you really get into the detail. And each of those is assigned a level. So they're level A, level 2A, and level 3A. And the those are kind of by priority. So level A are the highest priority. You know, those things that if you don't do them, you're going to exclude some group of people that just they're not going to be able to access your web page. And level 2A is the next level. Things that may be a little bit harder, maybe a little bit less critical, but still are pretty easy and pretty critical. So kind of level A and level 2A is really where the line has been drawn. That as we see legal cases and policies surrounding web accessibility, they tend to result in the person agreeing to comply with WCAG 2.0 at level 2A. And so that, I think, is pretty widely established now that that's the bar, that's what we need to be shooting for. So what does that mean exactly? Well, it means we need to add alt text for our images. We need to add captions to videos. We need to not use color as the only means of communicating information. So something like, required fields are in red, on a form field. That's not going to work for somebody that can't tell if the text is red. Proper heading structure, as we've talked about, having those H1s and H2s, having labels on form fields. So if you've got a form and you've got prompts, visual prompts that say, enter your first name here, enter your email here, those need to be tagged in such a way that the label, enter your email here, is actually connected to the form field. And so behind the scenes, the code unites those two pieces of information. So a person who's using a screen reader is there navigating through the form, then they hear these prompts. Otherwise, screen readers have to guess which prompt goes with which field, and sometimes screen readers either don't guess. Most screen readers don't guess. JAWS guesses, and sometimes JAWS gets it wrong. So we don't want JAWS to guess. We want to code the web page so that JAWS doesn't have to guess. And then also a visible indication of keyboard focus. So again, as you move around, as you take the no mouse challenge, move around on a web page without using a mouse, then you should be able to tell where you are at all points. And that actually is a very easy thing to do the markup that's available to us. So in addition to the W3C standards, we also have Section 508 standards. These are from the federal government, from the Access Board, and they accompany the Section 508 law, which was amended. This is Section 508 of the Rehabilitation Act, amended in 1998, and it requires accessibility of electronic and information technology developed, procured, maintained, or used by federal agencies. And the standards, so that was a 1998 law. The standards then were written by the Access Board, a federal agency, and they were published in 2000. And they cover a broad cross-section of information technology. So web pages is one of those, but also software, hardware, media, telecommunication, and standalone devices, such as information kiosks. That was 2000, so it's been a long time, and it's kind of, those standards are sort of showing their age, but they are working on a refresh that, the latest draft of that basically adopts the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines version 2.0 at level 2A as the Section 508 requirement. And even though that WCAG is web-specific, it actually is written in a way that really applies to a much more broad, the principles apply to a much more broad set of information technologies, not just websites. So the W3C's ARIA specification, as I mentioned, it helps to make dynamic, rich interfaces accessible. And so there's an example down at the bottom of the screen where, let's say you're filling out a form on a web page and you do something wrong, you enter an invalid email, And then a message pops up on the webpage somewhere, maybe the top of the page, says, you know, nice and visible and easy to spot, that says, the email you entered is not valid. Please try again. So if you're filling this out as somebody who can't see, you're just using a screen reader, then how would you know that that error popped up? This had been, for a very long time, a big problem with web pages, that things would happen in response to something that you did, but they would happen somewhere else on the screen, and the user doesn't have access to that. So with some very simple markup using ARIA, you can add role equals alert to this error message container, and that the function that that serves is it tells screen readers to announce this right now. So if a user experiences this, then the screen reader interrupts them at this point, because this is very important that they know that the email they just entered is invalid. And so it interrupts them with this information. And they don't lose their focus. They still stay exactly where they are on the page, but they now have this new information that they've just heard, and then they can respond accordingly. So very simple, again, role equals alert provides all that. That's the kind of thing that ARIA does. It adds tags to web pages that make complex things that are going on the page, you know, understandable to assistive technology users. And there are some low-hanging fruit. So if you are a web designer, developer, then adding ARIA landmark roles is a very, very easy thing that you can do today that doesn't break anything, doesn't even require any further testing, because it just works for screen readers and doesn't have any effect for anybody else. But that is things like, for the main content of the page, add role equals main. That communicates that this is the main content of the page. If you've got a menu, add role equals navigation. And that communicates that this is the navigation region, this is the menu. And so users then can very easily jump to those particular areas of the page and understand what the functionality of that area of the page is. So it really makes a big difference in just helping users to understand how the page is organized and structured, and a very, very simple markup. Yes, question. And here comes a microphone.
Thank you. I have a lot of concern because I see us moving to what I see as the sort of video game visualization of our communication. If it isn't suitable for a mobile app, then we kind of don't like it as much. It's not as cool. It doesn't, you know, explode pictures. It doesn't. It's very graphic oriented, and I've been expressing for a while now that isn't going to be very accessible to a broader audience, not to mention just size of screen issues, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So when we're trying to navigate between what keeps up with our, for lack of a better term, probably younger, more digitally focused constituency, how do we retain value for those who have different abilities in the first place, regardless of age? And frankly, those who aren't digitally connected, but could still use the benefit of these assistive technologies in 20 words or less.
Yeah, just two words, keep fighting. It actually goes back to your answer earlier when we were at the bottom of the steps. You pass a bill, although in just advocating and getting young people, because a lot of this is directed at young people. They're trying to reach young people. And yeah, I've got a son who's 18 and a daughter who's 16. And as I watch their response to pages like that, they don't like them. You know, they just want the information. They don't want a lot of bells and whistles. And I don't know, you know, how typical they are, but it seems, I hear this from a lot of people, that, you know, I think there are some marketing people, or, you know, somebody wants things that move. We've actually heard this at the University of Washington from high-level administration people, that it needs to move. And so our response is, why does it need to move? You know, what evidence do you have that moving is going to attract more people as opposed to turning more people off? And so that's, You know, if you feel that way, that, you know, moving parts does not necessarily make a website better, then, you know, do whatever you can to help sort of spread the word that maybe that's not a better thing. And ultimately, maybe data will help, that, you know, if we can collect some information that says, you know, people really don't respond well to this, then, you know, that could help too, you know, if we can present that to people who are making those sorts of decisions. So now, it's also important, though, to separate, you know, that aesthetic piece from the accessibility piece, because there's kind of a myth that accessibility is plain and ugly. And so we do find that we have to dispel that myth, that a lot of accessibility does not affect the visual look at all. Yeah, we just need to add the markup that's necessary to communicate what all the parts are, and then it becomes more accessible, to somebody that can't see it and so forth. But yeah, it's a good point. So a question near the back, and here comes a microphone for you.
To follow up on the lady's question in front of me over here to my left, what do we say, though? I mean, obviously, there might be ways to sort of, as you say, keep fighting. But I want to know more about the technology that's available to make some of those moving things and pictures. Are they just inherently inaccessible, those moving picture-y things, all of them? I mean, I know I should know this. I mean, I guess how I'm going to put this a different way. I think I know the answer, but I just want you to talk a little bit about that, if you would. Just talk about those moving graphical things. And
so, yeah. Aria, actually, if I'll go back a slide. I kind of intentionally skipped over this because I didn't want folks who aren't web developers to gloss over. But Aria's role is to answer questions like, what is this? How do I use it? What's its current state? Is it on? Is it off? Is it selected, expanded, collapsed, et cetera? What just happened, if something just happened? So a good example is a carousel, as we call them. It's like a slideshow. So you've got, you know, multiple moving parts. You see this on a lot of home pages now. Moving parts with maybe a few controls that allow you to advance or go back. Most of these are very inaccessible in that there's no communication of the structure. So a person who can't see doesn't know that there are five slides in this set. Or a person who can't use a mouse can't advance to the next slide or go back. All of those are solvable problems with Aria and with also adding, you know, maybe some keyboard functionality using in JavaScript. But there are other issues too, and Aria doesn't solve all the problems. And if you've got something that is constantly moving on a home page or on any web page, then that's going to be a problem for somebody who's easily distracted and has difficulty focusing. And so they're trying to read something else on the page, and then this content changes and draws their attention back to that content and away from whatever they're trying to read. So that can be very problematic for certain people, and no technology is going to solve that other than having a pause button. So that's a design decision, you know. Make it very easy for people to be able to pause this if they're distracted by the constant motion. Or what I actually argue for is don't play it automatically at all, but let users choose to play it. If they want animation, they can hit a play button and turn that on. But everybody else doesn't have to be burdened with that. So whose responsibility is all this? Going back to our five groups. We just talked about the standards. There are accessibility standards. The W3C provides the accessibility markup that we need in HTML. And web content accessibility guidelines very clearly spell out what needs to happen in order for web pages to be accessible. And ARIA provides that additional technology piece that makes it possible for complex interactions to be accessible. So they've done their part. We've got accessibility standards. Then assistive technologies need to support them. They do a pretty good job of that. Screen readers, anyway, do a pretty good job. There's room for improvement, but not bad. Dragon, naturally speaking, has not historically done a good job, but in version 13, they did add some support for ARIA. Which means, the problem with Dragon Naturally Speaking is a lot of times you'd have like what looks like a button, and it would have some text on it, and as a speech input user, you could say, let's say that button was a play button, and you would say, click play, and you would expect that to then trigger the play button. You know, it's the same thing as clicking on the play button with a mouse. But if that button isn't really a button, then Dragon doesn't understand what you just said. It's only listening for things that it knows are clickable, like links and buttons. And so if it's coded with something just neutral, with, you know, like div or span, then that's not something that Dragon recognizes as a button. And so you can say click play, you know, all day long, and it's not going to understand what you're talking about. But by adding role equals button to that markup, then Dragon, as of 13, now says, oh, okay, this is a button, and then it will understand when you say click play. So that's where assistive technology hadn't been very good on the speech input side of things, but now they're starting to catch up. And screen readers have been really working hard to support this stuff for a long time. What about web developers and content authors? That really is where there's a lot of burden right now, that you know, you all who are creating things need to understand what the standards are, and you need to develop according to those standards. So web authoring tools, ideally, you won't have to do so much as developers. You can just use tools that support the standards. You can use libraries that have, you know, the widgets that you want to plug into your web page, and they're all already coded for accessibility, so you don't have to worry about that stuff. They're just accessible, and you just, you know, choose them, plug them into your web page, and off you go. But we're not quite there yet, so we are at a point where web developers really do need to understand, you know, kind of the nuts and bolts of how accessibility works. And content authors do too. So if you're if you're adding content to a web page using an editor that's built into the website, then pay attention to things like headings. Every rich text editor, or most rich text editors, have some means of identifying the headings on the page. And so if you're adding, you know, a lot of content to a web page and it's going to be broken up into different sections, then you're going to need to add subheadings to break those sections into different chunks. And you need to do that not by making the text bold, because then it's not really a heading, it's just pretending to be a heading, but use the actual heading capabilities that are built into the editor. And sometimes it's kind of hard to find. You have to, you know, look around in the different drop-down menus and so forth, but it's there somewhere. Same thing with images. If you add images to a web page, make sure that you add alt text to it. And every tool that I know of that allows you to add images to web pages also allows you to add alt text. And so, you know, you need to look around for that somewhere. Sometimes it's called alt text, sometimes alternate text, sometimes text description, things like that. And we have a question.
A question I often get is, what guidance would you give someone around how to write alt text for an image? What are the things that you want to keep in mind to express about an image?
That's a good question. And it really, the goal is to describe the image succinctly and provide equivalent access. So if you think about what a sighted user gets out of this image, what you're trying to communicate, what its function is, that's what somebody who's using a screen reader or using a Braille device needs access to. And so We have here, actually, in the screenshot, we're inserting an image of Mount Rainier using Flickr. Flickr, this is the plugin's built into the Canvas learning management system, which we use on campus a lot. And it's got the ability to grab images, to search for images, grab them off of Flickr, put them on a web page, and they come already equipped with alt text. So that's nice. So the alt text for this image that I'm about to add is Mount Rainier. And the question is then, is that good alt text? Well, it's a photo of Mount Rainier, so it would seem to be, you know, reasonable. But what if this is a geology course, and my purpose in showing this image is showing how significantly the glacier is retreating over time? Then that's a very different thing that I'm trying to communicate. It's not just Mount Rainier, it's some specific detail. And so that would need to be included in the image, in the alt text. So short, sweet, equivalent communication, but depends on context. And there's some really good resources out there online that, you know, really go into lots of different examples and scenarios and so forth. So any questions about web pages before we jump into PDF? And here comes the runner.
Doesn't HTML5 address some of those ARIA roles that you talked about, like for navigation tags?
Yeah, ARIA came first, HTML5 came second, and HTML5 actually added some tags that replicate the functionality of some of the ARIA roles. And so right now we're kind of in a state where there's some redundancy. So like role equals navigation is a good example that, you know, HTML5, there actually is a nav tag. So you could use, you know, nav, N-A-V, as a tag instead of role equals navigation. But right now I advocate using both because ARIA came first. And so there are assistive technologies that did not support HTML5 tags but did support ARIA. And so users still are out there with those older versions. And so just to make sure that, you know, all needs are met for a little while anyway, until it's reasonable to assume that people have caught up and have more recent versions of assistive technology, then using both is a good idea. Other web page questions? Yes.
We tried to talk about, do you plan to talk about Facebook and interactive media, social media? Are you going to be talking about that later in the presentation?
Not specifically, although the three examples that I have are PDF is next, and then I want to talk about video. And then at the end, we can bundle all those together and talk about them in whatever context they happen to appear.
Great, thank you.
Okay. Sean?
Where's the mic? Oh, just a quick question about HTML5. I've heard from someone, and I'm wondering if you've heard this as well, that, HTML5 is accessible, so we'll just write it in that, and then it'll be accessible. I had to correct that person. That wasn't automatically true. But have you heard that kind of rhetoric or thought from others?
Well, it's nothing is automatic. And that is something we need to watch out for, is people that assume because they're using something that has some accessibility characteristics that it is automatically accessible. And there's always going to be a need for people just to be educated on how to use the tool. So for another example, as we're getting into to PDF, if you save as PDF from Microsoft Word for Windows, then it creates the right kind of PDF that has accessibility built in. And some people think, okay, I've got an accessible PDF because I saved as PDF using their proper techniques. But they didn't do all the things that are necessary, like add headings, add alt text, And there's no way that any, you know, that has to be a manual process. People have to understand that they need to do that, and they need to do that. So, yeah, there are those misconceptions. And another question in the back. Here comes the microphone.
Are you going to talk about like the sort of plug-in automated testing tools that people use to check if their content is accessible versus human testers at all?
I can, since you prompted. And I'll actually do that by referring you to my blog, terrillthompson.com, because I just wrote a blog post just within the last week where I compared a bunch of accessibility checkers on how they did with this one page that we know has at least 18 accessibility problems, and we know what those problems are. And so I just wanted to see which of the checkers could find those problems. And none could find all the problems, and most were half or less of the problems. So there are, false securities there too. And it's related to Sean's question, that people feel like, okay, well, I just, you know, ran this through a checker and I passed the checker, and so my page is fully accessible. But in fact, you know, it may be very difficult to use and may have some other problems that checkers didn't reveal. And so that too gives kind of a false sense of security. We actually have a problem at the UW. It's becoming more and more rare, but for a long time, you know, people would say, my site is accessible. I ran it by Terrill. And, you know, when in fact the feedback that I gave them was, your site really has a lot of problems. But they thought just by having me look at it, that sort of, they could check that off their list and, you know, everything's good. So, there's that other piece of the message, which is the details that people sometimes overlook. Okay, let's plunge into PDF. And really, the issues with documents are the same as the issues with web pages. There are lots of similarities. We don't want a big blob of text that has no meaning, no structure. We want a document that has structure. And PDF has the ability to do all the same things that HTML does. It has tags that communicate that headings are headings and lists are lists, and the ability to add alt text to images and all of that. You can do almost everything with a PDF that you can do with a web page. But not all PDFs are created equal. And so there are three general types. The first is just an image where somebody has scanned a document in and saved it as PDF, and it's just an image. Even if it looks like it's got text, it might not actually have any text at all. It's just a picture of text. So until you actually go in and convert that text or convert that image into readable text, it's completely inaccessible. That's the worst type, but there are a lot of those out there, particularly in high volume areas like libraries where they're scanning in journal articles and just saving them, you know, as image PDFs, and then students need to access those and they don't have any ability to read them. The second type is a document that has actual readable text but doesn't have any structure. And so that's the big blob of text, which is technically more accessible because it is readable text. But without structure, it's impossible to read. You could go there and say, there's no way a person can really read this. It's going to take forever. And the third type is a tagged, well-structured document. So that really is what we're after. And it's a special type of PDF. There is a type called tagged PDF that has this underlying tags mechanism that allows you to mark up the headings as headings and paragraphs as paragraphs and lists as lists and so forth. So tag PDF was introduced in 2001. Does that date ring a bell from earlier in the presentation? What happened right about 2000, 2001? This is the quiz portion of the... Okay, Section 508 standards came out in 2000, and the federal government was faced with, oh, wow, we're not going to be able to use PDF anymore because it's not accessible. So Adobe said, wait a minute, let's see if there's something we can do about this. And they introduced then in Acrobat 5 this new type of PDF that had this underlying tag structure. So it's been around for a very long time. It makes it possible to do all the things you can do in HTML, as I've mentioned, or most of the things. The trick is you have to use an authoring tool that supports it. And even though that was 16 years ago, there are still a lot of authoring tools that do not produce tagged PDF. You can't get there from here. So you create a document, you add headings, you add alt text to images and all that, and then when you go save as PDF, all of that accessibility work that you did is lost. It doesn't get passed on to the PDF. If you do it in the right tools, then it does. And so that's the trick, is knowing which tools support tagged PDF and which ones don't. Microsoft Word for Windows does, so that's a good choice of tools. Again, you have to do all the right things up front. You have to use headings, you have to add alt text to images, you have to use the list button if you're making a list, and all of that. But then when you go to save as PDF, you will have a tagged PDF, and all of that accessibility information will get passed to the PDF. Microsoft Word for Mac does not. So if you're a Mac user, then you've got to save as PDF from Windows. You've got to find a Windows machine to do that. Or there's some other workarounds too. And so if you really wanted to know what those are, then just ask me afterwards. But so Microsoft, we're hoping that they'll jump on board and provide the same functionality in the Mac version that they provide in the Windows version, but it's not there yet. Google Docs, a lot of people are using Google Docs to author content now. If you save as PDF from Google Docs, you do not get a tagged PDF. Adobe InDesign does create tagged PDF, but it's complicated. There's a particular workflow that you have to use in order to create a document that will be accessible. And that's way more than I can get into in the time that we have. So the thing is, there aren't a whole lot of tools that create tagged PDF, even though it's been around for 16 years, but you can fix inaccessible PDFs after the fact using Adobe Acrobat Pro. So regardless of how the document was created, you can pull it into Adobe Acrobat Pro and add accessibility. It has tools that allow a person to do that. So that was just a quick look. The question then, who's responsible for making PDFs accessible? Assistive technologies do support accessible PDF. So screen readers will read an accessible PDF, and a lot of the same functions that you use in a web page work in a PDF if it's accessible. Software and operating systems, Adobe Acrobat, Adobe Acrobat Pro, they provide that accessibility piece. The accessibility standards are there. Really, the WCAG, the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, is kind of, it tells us what we need in a document, and PDF makes that happen, so it's supporting the standards. The web authoring and development tools are falling short because they don't automatically create a tagged PDF. So this is an area where that group really needs to do a lot of work to step up and make it possible for people to create accessible content with their tools. And then web development and content authors need to know how to create an accessible document and which tools to use to save. If they want to export to PDF, they got to know what the right way is to do that and what the wrong way is. So that's a huge group to educate, and we're doing our best to try to get the word out there and encourage people to try and understand what that entails. Questions about documents? Yes, question in the front. Here comes the mic.
It's actually more of a comment in terms of the PDF documents. It's probably, as a access user, screen reader user, probably the most challenging piece for me are the number of attachments and documents that are sent in PDF format that are not readable. Mm. And quite frankly, just so everybody knows what happens when you open an attachment, it basically says text not found. There's nothing there. So it's actually one, even when you're sending around attachments, not as part of your websites, and just information to distribution lists or other, those PDFs are really important.
Yeah, and that's the percentage of PDFs that are out there that actually are accessible, they're even tagged, just tagged PDFs, is very, very small. And so there's a huge educational effort that's needed to, make people aware of this need, that as you're creating documents, you really have to be aware of accessibility and create, and just follow a couple of steps to make sure that your document is accessible.
Hi, and my question is the same thing, but now that the federal government is upgrading their standards, then anything put out by the federal government will have to follow WCAG and 2A, that's correct. And I myself have my own website, and I'm wondering how much I can do on this myself. I mean, I haven't really attempted it, but do you know if it's available on, the Google or the GoDaddy, and do they have this accessible to us that make our own websites?
Well, you have to take some of that on yourself, and hopefully the tools that you use will create accessible content.
But
ideally, you would just do whatever you do to create your web page, and the tool that you're using would create an accessible web page. So that, and I can't comment on those tools specifically, but some tools do a better job of that than others. So the only way to know, you can get some mileage out of using an accessibility checker, and just see what kind of feedback you get. And I'll share some resources at the end here too. So ultimately, there's no substitute for knowing a little bit about accessibility or talking to somebody that can sort of walk you through that. But yes, question in the front, and then in the back, and then in the back, other back.
I wanted to say that the web, Microsoft web version of Word, when you want an accessible version, it just generates a PDF. And I wanted to ask, when you said Word for Mac, were you referring to 2016, the latest version, or the previous version?
Both. 2016 still said, I was really, really optimistic when I got 2016, mm-hmm. that finally they're going to solve this, and I produced a PDF and I checked it, and still no tags.
They did a lot of work in 2016. They fixed a number of things compared to the previous version for Mac, but there's still a number of places where that's lacking.
Yeah. And right behind you, there's a question.
Just a quick question about PDF. You can convert it back into Word. I've never looked at it, but can you regain some of that formatting?
I don't know that I've done it that way. But I think... Yeah, I guess I can't really say without testing it first. And he's shaking his head, so it doesn't work that way. If you have a tagged PDF that has some accessibility, you import it into Word, then apparently you lose that that accessibility markup. And that works. There's a lot of opening documents and other word processing platforms. It's a mixed bag. What gets accepted, the accessibility features that get accepted, and those that don't, gets pretty messy and complicated, unfortunately. Yes?
Similar question about Word. It's like, which format? Because I have been told to make it rich text or even plain text takes away all the formatting, then it turns into PDF. So there's, a lot of confusion over just saying Word turns into a tagged PDF. If you save as.
Yeah, it really depends on your audience and what you know about that audience. And so if there's some assumptions that the audience has access to Microsoft Word or something that will open Word docs, which is a pretty reasonable assumption anymore, then just providing the document in Word really is probably the best bet, because it's got heading structure and it's got alt text for images and all of that. And if you then convert it to some other format, there's always the chance that you're going to lose some of that functionality. So problem with Word is it is a commercial product, and so historically we've said, there's no guarantee that everybody in your audience has Word or a tool that will open it. But now, I think there's so many free tools that support that format that it has become kind of a standard format. So I think best not to export, if possible, and if that works for your audience. Question? Yes.
I just had a brief statement to reply to. Is it Janice? You had the question about which website providers. I won't name any names, but the internet is rich with great information if you just ask it. Is WordPress accessible? Is Wix accessible? There's a lot of very good information out there. You can compare and contrast.
Okay. Let's move on to example three, videos. HTML5, we talked a little bit about that. It is accessible. It adds some really cool accessibility features. This is the video tag. And so to add video to your web page these days with HTML5, it's extremely simple. It could actually be much more simple than what I've got here, but this has full accessibility. So you've got a video tag and a closing video tag down at the end. And inside of that, you've got a couple of source tags, which is the video source. So, what the video, you point to the video file, and that's the video file that actually plays in the player. And we provide a couple of those because not all browsers honor the same video format. So MP4. Internet Explorer and Safari were all over supporting MP4. And Mozilla with Firefox and Opera said, no, we're not going to support MP4. There are licensing issues. And so WebM is a format that would get around that. So any browser that doesn't support MP4 probably supports WebM. So if you provide both, then one way or another, browsers are going to be able to play the video. So you got two source tags. But more importantly, we now have the track tag in HTML5. That allows us to have timed text that is synchronized with the video. And so captions can be delivered with the track tag, but so can descriptions. So you can have text-based audio description, which means the screen reader would read the description at the designated time, just like captions get displayed at the designated time. In this case, it would be descriptions get rendered at the designated time, and they would be read aloud by a screen reader. And there are other different kinds of tracks too that you can synchronize with the video. There are captions, subtitles into other languages other than the native language of the video, audio description, chapters, which allows you to add organizational structure to the video so people can jump directly to different parts of the video, and metadata, which is pretty much anything else, anything you want to synchronize with the video, your little pop-up messages that supplement the video or that kind of thing, is possible with the track tag. And it just looks like this. It's just sort of like a caption file, just plain text file that has a start time, an end time, and some text. And then how that actually gets used depends on what kind of track it is. So if it's kind equals captions, then it gets displayed in the caption area if the user has toggled captions on. And if it's descriptions, then it gets exposed to screen reader users so they hear it, with role equals alert, they hear it at the designated time. So there's a media player that we've developed because even though this capability is built into the HTML5 spec, browsers don't natively support most of what's possible. They support captions. I think every browser now supports captions in HTML5, but none of them support audio description, and none of them support chapters, and none of them support metadata. So we decided to just build our own, and so we built an HTML5 media player called Able Player which is a fully accessible player that takes advantage of what is possible with HTML5. So here you see a screenshot of a video playing in AblePlayer, and one of the cool things we do is we take the captions and the audio description and we combine them to produce an interactive transcript. So we've got all the timestamps and everything, and we reassemble that into a transcript, and users can click anywhere in that transcript to jump right to that point in the video and start playing in the video at that point. And when I say click, that suggests mouse, and obviously I'm the no mouse guy. Take the no mouse challenge. This is optionally keyboard accessible as well, but it's a preference. And so users can enable, yeah, they can say yes to keyboard accessibility and then tab through the transcript and press enter or space to start playing the video at that point. Now that's optional because that could really get in the way. It's a lot of tab stops if somebody is wanting to tab past the player and go somewhere else on the page. They don't want to get stuck, you know, in the mud of trying to get through that transcript. So they can enable that and then tab through it. But so AblePlayer is something worth checking out if you're looking for an accessible media player on web pages. It has a lot of functionality that no other player comes close to matching. And this is what we're using on the Do It video website. And I think I've got that URL coming up. So captions really are a great example of universal design. And accessible video as a whole is a great example of universal design because everybody benefits. And here's a screenshot of using YouTube. YouTube also has an interactive transcript function. So if you have a caption video, then you can read the transcript, click anywhere in that transcript, play the video at that point. The captions can be translated into any language automatically, that any of the languages that Google Translate supports. So that's only as good as automatic translation is, but it's pretty good. That I've heard from a lot of people that they understand the video. You know, if they don't understand English, they understand the video better because it's been translated into their native language. So that's all possible because we have captioned the video. Yes?
Hi there, I'm Adam, and I am a strong user of captioning. YouTube captioning isn't really where it needs to be because it uses an automated listening in order to pull in the captionings, and you get a lot of errors and a lot of miscaptions whenever you're using those sound speech reading text types of programs. So I'd rather have captions that are actually produced by a human being and have them embedded into the films rather than using those automatic sound type generated captions.
Yeah, we would love for YouTube or technology in general to be able to automatically caption things because there are so many videos out there, so many millions of hours of videos that will never be captioned, I mean, realistically. But if technology were up to the challenge of doing it for us, then that would be wonderful. But it's not there yet. I think it's gotten better, but it still is not suitable for actual use as captions. I would agree with that. I do think it's reached a point where it, for some videos, if it's a clear speaker in a good acoustic environment with good production, then it's good as a starting point. And YouTube provides an editor that you can use to go in and edit those captions that it came up with. And if they're 90% accurate, then it's not too hard to go in and edit those and make them 100%. A lot of times, though, if it's not very accurate, then it's easier just to start over from scratch. Just because when you're captioning, you get kind of a rhythm going that you don't get when you're editing existing captions, particularly ones that are really a mess. So, but yeah, there's also that false sense of security thing. A lot of people do sort of feel like, well, YouTube can caption this, so we don't have to do anything, and that's not the case. So the screenshot I have here shows the many other applications of captioning, that there's so many things that you can do with video if it's captioned. And this is something that was done with the last presidential election, where during the presidential debates, this was on Al Jazeera did this, where they had the caption text, and it was broken down by who was speaking. And so you could search for a key word that you wanted to find out who said this word and in what context. So in this example, I searched for America, and it showed that Mitt Romney said America more often than Obama did. And then you can look at the timeline and see, okay, when did they say America? And you can click and go right to that point in the video to see what the context was when they were talking about this. So it really opened up some doors for some analysis, that wouldn't have been possible if this hadn't been captioned. So just to sort of show an example of some of the possibilities that, are out there by having this, accessible. So who's responsible then for making videos accessible? And we've got the standards that tell us, how to caption video. And we've got, software and operating systems that support captioning video, that you can play video in all the browsers, HTML5 video, YouTube supports captions, Vimeo supports captions now. How do we get video captioned? Well, tools might be able to do it for us. YouTube is trying, but they're not there yet. So then it comes down to us, authors again, just taking that extra step to make sure that if you do produce video, that you also get it captioned. And there actually are lots of free tools out there that make that process very simple and actually kind of fun. So depending on how much video you're producing, knowing what those tools are can be very helpful. We use a tool called Amara, A-M-A-R-A, that is a really nice tool that supports free crowdsourcing of captions. So you put a video up there, and anybody can come and work together collaboratively to caption that video. So very nice tool, and there are several others like it that provide that same kind of functionality. So the road to better accessibility is long, but it's pretty beautiful. And if we all work together, I think we can enjoy that road. But there is a lot of work to do. One area where we can all continue to work together and continue the conversation is the Seattle Accessibility Camp, which is in the very early stages of being thought about and figured out. But if you are interested in staying abreast of this will be like a one-day event, probably, maybe one or two days, where people get together and brainstorm and share ideas and about technology accessibility, or maybe accessibility more broadly, but just a big community event surrounding accessibility. So if you're interested in that, then there's a website where you can get your name on a mailing list, and we'll send out announcements to anybody who signs up. And so that is at tinyurl.com/A11YCSEA2017. So tinyurl.com/A11YSEA2017. So, and if you need that again later, then just corner me and I'll be happy to share that with you. But that'll be sometime probably in early 2017. I think we're looking at doing it in like January or sometime early next year. A bunch of other resources. This is my last slide, so I'll leave this up. But kind of the hub of all things related to accessible technology at the University of Washington is uw.edu/accessibility. So the second slide up there gives you lots of resources related to web accessibility, document accessibility, video accessibility. You've got links to resources that we find to be very helpful. How-to guides for our campus community, but other people can use them too, that sort of walk you through step-by-step how you create an accessible document or how you create an accessible web page, that sort of thing. There's 30 web accessibility tips, which is a nice resource. They're Able Player, my blog, terrillthompson.com, and these slides, I understand, are available via the this event, that there's a URL where I think you all probably have access. And there's also a flyer up front, a little trifold that works as a bookmark, but also if you open it up, it's got some tips on accessible web design. So I brought a whole bunch of those, you know, more than enough for everybody here, I think. And feel free to take a few extra and spread them around, spread the knowledge. So I've only got 7 minutes left officially, but I'm happy to stick around as long as we are allowed to stick around and answer any questions that you have. So it's one up front.
In your role at the university, do you have any ability to vet the tools that are used? And one thing comes to mind, for example, would be Google Docs, I know, is used. And Google Spreadsheets, for example, at least on the Mac, is not the most accessible thing. Do you have the opportunity to give feedback as with the voice of the university to companies saying, you know, this is a difficult tool for a class to use if some of the folks in that class need a screen reader or have some other need that the technology doesn't quite meet yet?
Yeah, that's a great question. And we do, in fact, try to be at the table and proactive with major purchasing or procurement decisions. And so we're actively working now with UW Procurement to develop procedures by which whenever an RFP goes out, accessibility language is included in that RFP. So vendors know that we want accessible products. And then when they come back with a response, you know, that's kind of the tricky part because there's so many things that are purchased. But we, within Accessible Technology Services, for major purchases, want to be at the table as a resource and, you know, helping them to judge those responses that come back from vendors. We want to be able to look at product and see if it's accessible. And we want to, if it's not accessible, but it's the front runner, then we want to be able to interact with the vendor and talk to them about their accessibility and collaborate with them to help them understand what our needs are. And so we do do that and are very actively engaged with a number of vendors right now, helping them to address their accessibility. And one of the things that we're kind of working on now and hoping to get to is actually have accessibility built into the contracts where, you know, if we can say, we realize that you're not accessible now, you know, but you've expressed a commitment and, you know, here's a roadmap and we expect you to meet certain deadlines en route to improved accessibility. And if you can do that, then we'll renew this contract next year, you know, that kind of thing. And so we're making some progress in that area and hope to really see that help to drive the market for accessibility. Particularly if it's not just us, but other institutions that are doing the same thing. And there are actually quite a few. There is a movement in higher education to demand accessibility from vendors. And the more they hear that from all of us, the more they're going to understand that this is a serious market opportunity. Nobody's accessible. So if we can be the most accessible, then that's really going to position us above the competition. So that's the message that we're trying to communicate to them. Question in the back.
Hi, my name is Marcy Carpenter. I'm the president of the National Federation of the Blind of Washington. The National Federation of the Blind offers a lot of consulting type services. We have a lot of resources available to help companies and government entities with accessibility questions. We also have people who use our members who use a lot of different access technology who are available to do human testing. So I'll be around after the session if you want to talk to me.
Great. Thanks for introducing yourself. Other questions? Another question in the front.
My question is, it goes to the, again, so the testing access or usability, and there's sometimes different things there. Mm-hmm. But so I know that a lot of people will use a tool, like the plugin tool, to check for accessibility. Some people may use in-house staff or developers or something. Does this seem accessible? Is JAWS reading this or whatever? And then most people skip the most important phase, which is phase three, which is a third-party tester. Third-party user testing for actual users. So, what are your thoughts on those three phases? That they do they need to work together to actually create an accessible environment once you're building websites and other things?
Yeah, I think there really is no substitute for user testing in particular. And we've talked about accessibility checkers and the limitations of those, and also big limitations with. Input that comes in from vendors. Vendors will often fill out what's called a voluntary product accessibility template, a VPAT, which is a checklist of how they feel they perform on accessibility. And sometimes those are just either blatantly false, or they don't understand how to evaluate their products for accessibility. And so, you know, you just don't get accurate information from them. So you have to look at what vendors tell you, but you also have to question that. You have to use automated checkers if they're available, and you have to develop in-house expertise in order to be able to make some intelligent decisions as you look at products. But ultimately, there is no substitute for having users test, and that can be challenging because then you have to figure out, okay, where do the users come from? And so we're fortunate with Do-It, having been around since 1993, and we have constantly, you know, new groups of students coming into our program, that we've got a pretty large body of students that we can tap into, and we're always looking for ways to empower them and get them involved in, checking products or captioning videos or, you know, doing other things that are related to accessible technology. It's going to help them develop some skills and advocacy skills and technology skills, but also provides a benefit to us. So, and we've talked about trying to figure out how to harness that community that we have and make it available for others, but so far we don't have anything formalized there. It has been mentioned NFB is available to do some of that kind of stuff, and there are other groups as well. So. Yes, question right behind you.
Hi, I'm Sherry Pirazzoli with the Hearing Loss Association of Washington, and I'd just like to give a big shout out to Irene Stewart for making this program what we call hearing friendly or hearing accessible, because most places don't think about how people are going to hear when they have a program. And so the key to hearing friendly programs is to start with a microphone. And so you'll see that the presentation had microphone access all the way around. And I really appreciate each of you taking having patience in waiting for the microphone to show up. Irene also went above and beyond and has arranged to have all of her meetings CART captioned, and ASL is available. So I just really like everyone to think about how people are going to hear your message, whatever it may be, and I strongly encourage everyone to think about captioning your videos. Any content that does not have captioning is not accessible to people who have any kind of hearing loss or who may be deaf. But thanks again.
Terrill, thank you very much for this information. It's amazing to me how consistent the message is regarding either digital communications or our built environment, that it's really so much easier to consider different abilities up front than it is to try to fix it later. So this is great information, and I really appreciate all of you being here today. I would also really encourage you If you would like to join the listserv for the Northwest Universal Design Council, you can access that at our website, environmentsforall.org. I don't know how accessible it is, Irene, if you've tested it.
It's in the process.
We're in the process. So we're all learning here. Also, I might bring up, too, Wendy, your last name is Pender, is from Bellevue Libraries and has some information on the front desk up there, along with information relevant to the meeting today on an assistive technology and resources fair that's going to be at the Bellevue Library Saturday, May 14th from 11 to 3. So you might pick up information on that and plan on attending that as well. Again, thank you to everybody here today. Thank you, Irene, especially. One of the things that we really encourage with the Universal Design Council is getting people of like minds together. So I encourage you to network as much as you can with the people around you and carry this forward from this day on. So again, thank you, everybody. Big round of applause for this.